You know, I will take full responsibility for something here. I keep forgetting to tell you guys that you should have brought these with you. But I think it's okay. If you were a little confused about this morning, I put two maps in here on Brandywine. One is a very broad map of Brandywine. The first map is that.
Much easier than his.
This is all in your books I gave you. I should have reminded you that. You bring these with you and you can see these. All these maps that I picked out and photocopied for you, most of these I use with my students because it's very broad. That map you got this morning, I about folded that thing in half because it knotted me in my stomach because I can't understand that. So this is, you hear the two maps that if you want to use them with your students of Brandywine. Remember, along the creek, Hal comes in and he sends Knyphausen right into the gut of the Continental Line. Why does Hal begin to move north?
Surprise. That's what you said.
At Brandywine.
Yeah, see, he was trying to get back up to Burgoyne.
Okay, here is, please stand here. Face that way. You're Knyphausen.
I don't want to see
that. Not Knyphausen. Come on, that's Dookie Hauser. Well, who do you want to be?
Washington.
How?
You just told me you don't want to be Knyphausen. It's Knyphausen.
Hausen.
Knyphausen.
Okay. It's okay. I'm teasing. I'm here.
Continental Line. Brandywine Creek. You Yankees call it the Brandywine River. Is that a river? That's a creek. That's a creek. You know, anybody says that's a Brandywine River, is that, well, you know what? I'm 7 feet tall. So you're Knyphausen. You're the Continental Lines. You're Hal. Take one step in. Start moving that way. Why does Hal go north?
To get across the river.
He is going to flank Washington's line along here. Hal and Cornwallis. So Hal goes north. And how many fords were up there?
There were nine.
Okay, so there would be two fords that Hal knows that are up. Here are my points. One, how does Hal know there are fords up there?
Because he was scouting. He had scouts.
Spies, scouts, intelligence. Why doesn't Washington know those fords are up there?
He sat around for 2 days.
He blew the intelligence here at Brandywine.
He didn't scout for 2 days.
He blew it. He really blew it here at Brandywine. For whatever reason, he does not go out and he scouts this region. Hal has never been here before in his life, and he knows those fords are there. And remember, your American Pageant book said this is an inferior general. Hal knows that that's there. He's never been here before. He knows they're there. So one, Hal is going to flank Washington's line at Brandywine. And the reason he can flank Washington is because he has intelligence. What happened on 9/11 is because we let down on our intelligence. We relied on satellites and drones, and we took our intelligence off the ground. And intelligence is piece by piece by piece by piece by piece. You can't get good intelligence with drones and satellites. We have got to go back to boots on the ground. I don't mean military necessarily, intelligence.
Human intelligence.
Human intelligence. Remember, how did we get Bin Laden?
Human intelligence.
Remember that Pakistani doctor that gave us with, and what did they do with him? Yeah, he's in prison. But anyway, so Hal gets intelligence that there's Fords up there. Washington has no clue for 3 hours that Cornwallis and Hal are flanking him because he sees
Knyphausen
crashing into him. He gets three reports.
There's nothing out there.
And then the fourth report goes, we don't know either. And so Hal comes up here and he flanks Washington's line because of intelligence. And so what happens is, now you gotta turn.
Which way?
This way. You gotta turn. Because Washington, remember Sean showed you all this on his interact. Guys, use those maps with your kids. Use those maps with your kids. Washington has to turn his line, and remember what happened to Sullivan out here. Remember?
Yes. The turn.
I tell you what, I laughed so hard at that because my tall son, when you ask him something to do, this is what he does. Corey, where are your keys and your wallet? They're right there on the counter in the kitchen. So what does he do? He circles around my other son, who's like my wife, the type A. Boom, he grabs him and he's out the door. So Washington has to turn his line. Knyphausen was told to wait an hour before he comes crashing into the line here, so Hal can go up and begin to flank. Knyphausen does that. Washington's got to turn his lines over here to protect him so he doesn't lose his army. So when he does that, he's still got to watch out for Knyphausen. And the Hessians come in here. There's 8,000 of those guys. Hal has 13,000 total between himself and Cornwallis coming up here. This is massively large. I've read some that says Hal has almost 17,000 guys up here compared to Washington's 11. So he's flanked here. He's got to turn his line. And then when the British start crashing in here, he's got to hold on to get the heck out of here. Which was
Green,
and then Anthony Wayne. And so basically, the Continental Line has to go that way, back down into Chester. And Green and Wayne hold the British here from having the total collapse of the Continental Army here. It is a military victory for Hal. It's a pyretic victory for him at great loss. Great loss here. For Hal, even though militarily wins. My last question is, why does Hal, he flanks Washington at New York, and he flanks Washington here. He is trained militarily with frontal assaults. European style is frontal assaults. Mm-hmm. Why does Hal flank Washington at New York and then again here?
Because so bad at Breed's Hill, they were just up and down straight up. He learned from the mistake of Kate or whoever was there, Paige.
Is Hal reacting to Breed's Hill?
Yes.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
Remember, Hal was leading the command at Breed's Hill. He lost 43% of his men on frontal assaults up Breed's Hill. He lost every one of his line officers at Breed's Hill. It's the bloodiest battle of the whole American Revolution is Breed's Hill. Hal lost 1,400 men at Breed's Hill. He's not having frontal assaults anymore. So he flanks him at New York. He flanks him here. Again, how much of life is reaction and reaction? Hal learns that and begins to flank the Continental Lines, throwing Knyphausen in here. And again, I'll say for the fourth time, and this is an inferior general? So Washington has to retreat back down into Chester, and then Hal comes north. Hal sweeps up through Westchester. He sweeps up through Westchester. And then the Battle of the Clouds And then Howe is above. Washington is up here. This is Valley Forge. Howe is in here. Washington is up here. And so what happens is Wayne is here. Washington says to Wayne, go harass the British and see if you can steal some of their supplies, because they're pillaging all over the place here. And there's wounded all over the place. There's a church right down the street. Again, most of these churches were hospitals. When my wife and I got married, we were going to a very large church. It had no center aisle. What do I care about a center aisle? Because the guys come in from the side, correct? But the woman with the $900 dress that they wear for 2 hours has got to come down the middle aisle, yes? With the long, what do they call that thing? The caboose? Train. The train, yeah. Caboose is when you get older. Okay. We can't get married in our church. Why? It doesn't have a middle aisle. We have to find a church. I know the church. Let's go look at it. So we went to walk, we went and looked at this church. It's in the colonial era building. The big, you know, the big wood pillars inside. It's got a nice sloping aisle down front. And she's looked at me, she says, this church is beautiful. It's gorgeous. I can't believe that you would even think about this. It's so romantic.
It's the last point you made.
The hospital, how many people died in that building?
400 Continental soldiers died.
In that church?
In that sanctuary. After Brandywine. What better way to begin a marriage?
In a haunted building.
In a building where 400, and now 401 have died. So that's what we're looking at down the street here. So Wayne is underneath, he's behind Howe's lines, Washington is above him, and Washington says to Wayne, harass the British, see if you can get some supplies. And that would get you here. This is Malvern Preparatory School. And the students that get thrown out of here and come to my public high school have been prepared for a lot of things, none of them academically. Remember I told you 10 minutes ago to trust me? Mm-hmm. Could you give me 30 seconds of trust? Would I bring you to a sacred battlefield where there's a carnival?
Yes.
No, I didn't know there was going to be a carnival, did
you? Never answer a question with a question.
Never answer a question.
Have I
the
yet,
answer to.
Have I yeah. yet, Marilyn, have I yet led them astray this week?
No, sir.
You got her trained.
Oh, no, I don't.
You got her hoodwinked.
Oh, no, I don't. The carnival is behind you. The battlefield is down there. Okay. That's where we're going in like 5 minutes. If I don't continue to get interrupted with Knipphausers or whatever your names are.
Knipshins.
Everyone have Knipshins. So another, why is Wayne here?
Because Washington told him to.
No, look down below. The textbook cancers.
You life. Just told us that.
But why is he on this piece of land?
Oh, he's from here.
Bingo!
He knows the area.
If you go straight across the field, you're right on the back edge of Wayne's property. We're all going, if we decided yesterday that we're going to have a paintball contest yesterday morning up in Trap, I want one of you on my team. Marilyn. It's
area.
Marilyn. I know the area. Marilyn doesn't know.
Oh, okay.
That's the point. I know the area. We're going to beat you in paintball because I know the landscape up there. You don't. Wayne knows this. He's about 900 yards away from his home. And so why not be here? Now, I'm going to finally get to your answer. You asked a great question 3 days ago. In the middle of the night, Wayne is out on these fields. He gets word that the British are coming up onto him here. So what Wayne does as a general, he puts out more pickets. He puts out more guards surrounding him here, put more out there. the British decided they're going to have a night attack on Wayne with General Bragg. So he ordered his men to take the flint out of their muskets so that they would not fire and they would not spark. It was a very dark, dreary night. There was no moon. There was no moon. And so he orders his men to take the flint out of their muskets so they won't spark, and they're going to use their bayonets. And they came up to Wayne's pickets. And not one of, that's hard to say, not one of Wayne, you silly rabbit. Not one of Wayne's pickets signaled that there's British coming. Because the British had Wayne's password to get into the camp. And how did they get Wayne's password, and how did they know where Wayne's troops were set up?
Spies.
One of the farmers that's next to Wayne.
Doesn't like Wayne.
Property dispute.
And I still contend it's the Griffith farm. He was a loyalist. Remember I told you 2 days ago, Wayne ticked off a lot of people? Wayne was not a well-liked guy. He was that neighbor that you just want to drive past. Or drive past their trash cans and kick them over before the trash men come. Oh, we all want to do that to somebody, correct? He is dined out by the local Tories, Wayne, and his campsite is known, his pickets are known, and because officers talk, they know the password. And so they are able to get inside of Wayne's pickets and then make a bayonet charge on the Wayne's troops over here. Which, you know, it's the Paoli Massacre. It's the Paoli Massacre. And when this is over, Ray has his men come in, bayonet Wayne's men, charge through the camps, and the other part of your answer is, well, how does Gray's men know where the camps are? Not at 1 o'clock in the morning.
The campfires of the
Bingo, I'm sorry, I don't mean to put campfires. Look at the campfires, and because it's so dark, the campfires illumine more where there's campfires. There's guys. And I know what you do. You multiply a campfire by four, and that's basically how many men are here. So if you go out and do some recon, and you come back and say, General Knipduzihauser, there's 5,000 men in that camp. Well, how do you know that? I counted the campfires. And you multiply that by four, and you get a pretty good approximate. So the campfires are so dark, the British know where these guys are. And Wayne's men can't see these guys. And they're screaming and yelling and bayoneting Wayne's men in the middle of the night, which becomes known as the Paoli Massacre. The British the next day said they killed 600. Out on that field where you're going to walk to, the farmers the next day counted 52 bodies of Wayne's men. We believe that probably 140 were casualties, the 52 killed and others wounded, and a couple either ran or deserted. Is that a massacre?
Massacre? No, but
it's all
massacre
relative.
Sounds terrible. It wasn't a massacre.
Never answer a question with a question. Was this really a massacre?
No.
Less than 10% of Wayne's men. He had 1,400 men. Less than 10% are killed here. Then why do they call it a massacre?
Propaganda.
Why do we call it the Boston Massacre?
Propaganda.
How many of those British soldiers were convicted?
Two, just barely.
Manslaughter. What? Two were convicted of manslaughter, which means their thumbs were branded with a cross for the rest of their lives. By the way, who represented those British
John
soldiers?
John Adams.
Why?
Because he felt everybody needed a representation.
That's Tuck's textbook.
They were in the right, in his opinion.
They were acting in
self-defense. And he was a contrarian. He liked to go against the mold.
Soldiers were being harassed.
He
needed money.
Samuel Adams, his cousin, talked John Adams into representing those seven British soldiers. Is John Adams the best lawyer in the nation at the colony? Yes. Samuel Adams knew that John would take the case because everybody had should have representation, and Samuel Adams knows that his cousin will get those soldiers off. And if those soldiers get off, is that going to, what we're talking about this morning, it's going to continue to instigate anger for the revolution.
They're in those Kent State soldiers.
You're missing up decades here.
Well, but I think the circumstances are similar.
No, we never know who fired those shots.
No,
at
they
Kent
don't
State.
Know who fired them.
So we knew again, something else, we look beyond, below the surface, and again, this is what excites me as an amateur historian and an old man, that you continue to dig this stuff up and it excites you, and if it excites you, what's it going to do to your kids?
Excite them,
you know. We all have a passion for this stuff. Continue to dig for your passion.
Sam.
Throw that textbook aside, not that you throw it out. Keep digging.
Sam encouraged John.
Absolutely. And Sam knew that John would get him off. If those soldiers were convicted,
we're done.
Adams wanted to get them off to continue to
fuel the fire. Yeah.
So, Boston Massacre, Paoli Massacre. Now, Wayne, in a year and a half, uses the same strategy against the British up at Stony Point. He attacks them in the middle of the night with bayonets. At Germantown, in the end of this campaign, Wayne's men are now charging the British lines, yelling, "Remember Paoli, remember Paoli, remember Paoli." At Yorktown, the Americans and French that stormed redoubts 9 and 10 that are now falling down into the ocean, they used the same strategy that General Gray's men used here against them. Right? Malvern Prep wanted to sell that property back there. It's ironic that there's a carnival. You all panicked that there's a carnival on this battlefield. There was the carnival's here. But 9 years ago, they were going to sell that property back there to a developer. They needed money. Our state, or our federal, our House of Representatives, Kurt Weldon, and the Historical Society here, raised $8 million to buy that property back there and preserve it.
Wow.
So they did that, and Kurt Weldon did that, to preserve it. And so they've done some other monuments back there. They've done some interpretation back there. There's a mass grave of the 52 soldiers back there, so we can walk back there. General Sumter, or Colonel Sumter, ran. Not as a chicken, but he ran away from the British. He jumped into a swamp at 2:30 in the morning. And he hid in the swamp, and he was perfectly silent. He stayed awake all night, never, barely even breathed, he writes later. Thinking that they're not going to get me here, when the sun came up, there was 50 other of Wayne's men that had also jumped in the swamp that didn't know each other was there. That's how dark it was that night.
Wow.
But the campfires illumined the door for Gray's men to get in here. Okay? Right?
Campfires acted like
a spotlight. There's a lot of interpretation boards back there. There's some monuments back there. See the mass grave. So let's walk back there and see the property. And it goes back that way.